there is you, the first class citizens of the world. Now, stay tuned for...
Hello, this is Harlem 411. Harlem 411, Information Radio on Harlem Community Radio. Listen for Issues and Answers of the Community, Politics, Education, Drug Abuse, Housing, Crime, Jobs, Civil Service, Community Planning Board, Public Health, Religion and the Community, and much more community affairs, all on Harlem 411.
Good evening, Harlem the Heights and beyond. Happy to be back with you after Sandy. Safe and secure here in the studios of WHCR 90.3 FM on your radio dial. And wishing you a joyous Friday after a big win. But anyway, let's get to the news. Headlines for November 5th from Democracy Now! New York City faces housing crisis for 40,000 displaced residents. New York City subway service has been mostly restored in the city slowly as the city slowly continues its recovery. But with Sandy flooding and damaging thousands of homes, New York City Mayor Michael Bloomberg warned of new housing crisis for up to 40,000 displaced residents in need of shelter. This is from the mayor, quote, "We don't have a lot of empty housing in this city, so it's really a problem to find housing when we need it. We are not going to let anybody go sleeping in the streets, and we're not going to let anybody go without blankets, food, and water. But it's a challenge, and we are working on that as much as fast as we can. On top of the displacement and loss of power, the recovery from Sandy will see further strain later this week when the early season nor'easter storm hits New England and the surrounding region." And let's see what we have. Okay, we'll move on to the next thing. Okay, here we are. Report this on the Israeli military. The Israeli military refused orders to prepare for Iran strike. An Israeli television network is reporting that Israel's military leaders rebuffed orders from Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu and Defense Minister Ehud Barak to prepare for a bombing of Iran 2 years ago. According to Channel 2, Netanyahu and Barak directed the military to ready an imminent strike on Iranian nuclear sites, but their order was rejected after Israel's top army officials concluded that doing so would be illegal and set off a dangerous chain of events that could lead to a global conflict. Moving on. Let's see what we have here. Okay. We won't take any of that. Okay. The GOP retains House control. Democrats keep Senate. President Obama will again face a divided Congress with Democrats increasing their Senate majority by one seat and Republicans holding on to control of the House. Democrats retain the Senate after winning a series of key races in Indiana, Massachusetts, Missouri, Connecticut, Nevada, Montana, and other states. In Indiana, Democratic Republican Joe Donnelly defeated the Republican state treasurer Richard Murdoch, who became famous for suggesting pregnancies resulting from rape were God's will. In Virginia, Democratic former governor Tim Kaine beat Republican George Allen, also a former governor, for the Senate seat. In Ohio, the Democratic Senator Sherrod Brown held on to his Senate seat in the campaign that saw outside groups spend tens of millions of dollars to defeat him. In Connecticut, Democrat Chris Murphy defeated Republican nominee and wrestling magnate Linda McMahon. And let's see what we have. Okay, on the 8th, it's November 8th from Democracy Now! Winter storm blast area devastated by Sandy. A powerful winter storm again blasted the northeastern United States, bringing wet snow and strong winds to areas already devastated by last week's superstorm Sandy. Tens of thousands of homes and businesses lost power along the East Coast from the Carolinas to New York on Wednesday, joining the more than half a million customers who still remain without power in Sandy's wake. Marijuana reforms in Colorado and Washington. Advocates for marijuana reform are preparing for a showdown with the federal government following historic victories in Colorado and Washington. Voters in both states approved measures legalizing marijuana for recreational use. The first time ever that has been achieved by a popular vote. The Justice Department is reviewing the ballot measures and is widely expected to challenge the implementation. On Wednesday, marijuana reform activists in Colorado and Washington said they were hoping to provide a model for the rest of the country. And also, women make historic gains in the U.S. Senate. Tuesday's election was a historic one for women, who come January will hold 20 out of 100 seats in the U.S. Senate, the largest number ever. Tuesday's election saw five new women elected to the Senate, in addition to Democrats Elizabeth Warren in Massachusetts and Representative Tammy Baldwin in Wisconsin. Democratic Mazie Hirono was elected in Hawaii, becoming the first Asian American woman elected to the Senate. Hawaii's first woman senator, the Senate's first Buddhist, and the first U.S. senator born in Japan, Fukushima, Japan. And so that's what we have from Democracy Now! We move on to local news. And America, we did it. That's on the front page of the Colbert Chronicles. The die is cast under the leadership of Barack Hussein Obama. The Democrats will occupy the Oval Office for the next 4 years. The election appears to be back and forth, but in the end, the intellect of American voters won the day. That on the front page of this week's Colbert Chronicles. On the Daily Challenge from Thursday, a barometer to tackle old and new issues. Barack Obama stepped into the White House 4 years ago as an agent of change, the nation's first black president, won re-election as the Study As She Goes defender of the new status quo. He will have 4 more years to try and enact sweeping changes that could affect the U.S. for decades. From the Beacon, and I'm not sure about this headline, but anyway, it says Obama wins by a whisker. I think he won by a couple of whiskers. But anyway, Electoral College to officially declare a winner on December 7th. And it shows a smiling Barack Obama with a baby. Now, the final call. Let's see. Front page of the final call. Another calamity strikes America. Superstorm Sandy's deadly assault upends lives, destroys businesses, and will have lasting effect, says stunned officials. And the article this week by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan is on page 20, Responsibility for Well-Being of American People Rests Primarily on Leadership. One more time, here we go. The Amsterdam News, 4 more years. President Obama wins a decisive victory. I like that better. Re-election in Florida, euphoria takes over New York. And so there you have it. And that's what's in the news for this week. And as always, go out and support your local news papers and news organs. The Final Call, The Daily Challenge, The New York Beacon, The Covert Chronicles, The Black Star News, and anything else you can get your hands on. And compare it with what you read in the Daily News, The New York Post, and The New York Times. Make comparisons, connect the dots. So learn to listen, listen to learn, connect the dots, and be informed. Be right back.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Are you a singer, a musician, or a producer? Are you looking to record a demo, a song, or an entire album? This is Angela Harden, General Manager of WHCR 90.3 FM, and I'm excited to tell you that you no longer have to travel all the way downtown to record your project. WHCR offers a state-of-the-art recording studio with an experienced engineer. Our studio is affordably priced and conveniently located in the heart of Harlem, right here on the campus of City College. For rates and information, please call 212-650-7147. That's 212-650-7147. Harlem has its own radio station and its own recording studio.
To accommodate the number of patients that were affected by Hurricane Sandy, the Nor'easter, and transportation challenges, the MLK-1 Ronald H. Brown Harlem Hospital Ambulatory Care Medical Clinic and pharmacy service hours are as follows. On Friday, November 9th, the Ronald H. Brown Building, full ambulatory care operation hours are from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. The walk-in primary medicine clinic, 4 p.m. to 8 p.m. Pharmacy, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. On Saturday, November 10th, the Ronald H. Brown Building, walk-in primary medicine clinic, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Pharmacy, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. Possible pediatric session pending. Sunday, November 11th, the MLK-1 Building, fast track, 10 a.m. to 8 p.m. On Monday, November 12th, the Ronald H. Brown Building, walk-in primary medicine clinic, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m., pharmacy, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. The Ronald H. Brown Clinic and pharmacy are located in the Ron Brown Building at 137th Street between Lenox and Fifth Avenue. The medical clinic is located on the third floor, the pharmacy located on the first floor. The MLK-1 Building is located on the corner of 135th Street and Lenox Avenue. If you need additional information, contact the Ambulatory Care Administration Office at 212-939-8044. That's 212-939-8044.
People, mine is in your way. No more tears, do we cry? And we have finally dried our eyes, and we're moving on up, moving on up. Lord have mercy, we're moving on up, moving on up. We're living proof and all's alert that we're two from the good black girl, and we're a winner.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Like your leaders tell you to, at last that blessed day has come, and I don't care where you come from, we're all moving on up.
We're going to move on up. Yes, we are. Yes, indeed. We're going to get a little something. But before we do that, we are happy to be back here in the studios after being windblown and tossed about by Sandy. And then the Northeaster came, laid down a blanket of snow on us. But we won, those of us that voted for Barack Obama. So we're happy about that. And we have our own Keziah Glow back from the Dominican Republic. Looking all tanned and sassy and ready to go. She is here. She's laid back. She said it was mellow. How was it?
I don't want to make any jokes. That's where I was at
during
Sandy. So we had this conversation. I got stuck.
Okay. All right. Okay. Well, that's good. Well, we're happy to see you again and happy that you're well and safe on these shores. We're going to be talking in a moment with Louis Lopez, and Louis he's in education, and he's been on these airwaves before, but he's an all-purpose guy, and he's been out to Rockaways, so I figured that we need to get an update as far as what's going on out there, what's he been doing out there. So, Louis, are you there?
Yes, I am. How you doing?
I'm doing okay. Tell us about, you know, what you've been doing and what it looks like out in the far Rockaways.
Well, I was just out there yesterday evening for the first time. I hadn't made it out there yet. Mm. And, you know, I got hooked up with a couple of organizations that are doing work on the ground, and we're doing it right the day after it happened, or in some cases even during the storm. And one of them is an offshoot or a continuation of the Occupy Wall Street movement, and it's a lot of the same folks that became active and got to know each other in that environment, who created several local neighborhood responses and now a citywide response as well to the damage that Sandy has done. Mm-hmm. So it's called Occupy Sandy. The website is occupysandy.org. And let's see, I might as well just go ahead and give contact info, and I'll give the number again later. Mm-hmm. It's 347-470-4192. They have several centers for volunteers to go and do some work, either at the receiving clearance house kind of situation, working on sorting, receiving and sorting donations for all the supplies that are needed. And also tomorrow and Sunday, especially on weekends, they're relying on volunteers with vehicles to be able to drive out there because there's still little other ways to get to the affected areas.
How did you get out there?
I was at the one of the main centers for receiving and sorting goods and filling orders for supplies, which is St. Jacoby's Church in Sunset Park in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that you can take the train to, and you're a block away when you come up. It's on 54th Street and 4th Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
And you can just show up, or you can contact them ahead of time. But if you show up, they'll give you a volunteer orientation. If you have any special skills, let them know. Not just things that are needed right now, obviously, or something like, you know, medics and things like that. We're dealing with cases of hypothermia, among other things, mm-hmm. seeing as the cold just kind of came in on us.
Sure.
And you know, and even if it isn't completely freezing, if you're in a damp environment with no heat all the time and you're not getting warm meals, just exposure kind of works on you after a while. So a lot of what people have been doing, what people did in the Red Hook Initiative too, in the neighborhood of Red Hook, is to go door to door in buildings to see if anybody was stuck at home, if not just people who are bound to their beds and unable to move normally, but sometimes you might have been okay and then you get to a point where you're not fine. So even if you have no medical skills, you can be the person that locates potential patients or potential people who might need assistance and go from there and be able to get help to them.
Mm-hmm.
So all these things, if you just contact the one number, they can direct you to different neighborhoods. Right now, under Occupy Sandy, there's centers in Clinton Hill, Sunset Park, Lower East Side, Rockaway itself, Staten Island, and Coney Island. But the main ones are Clinton Hill and Sunset Park. Those are the ones that, if you haven't been involved yet, you should try and get to those two if at all possible, because that's where you're going to get the orientation and be plugged in better.
Mm.
And from there, where I was, I brought a bunch of supplies down and just got busy right away helping to organize all the other stuff that was coming in along with my own. And within a few hours, most of it was gone by the time dusk was rolling in on us. So stuff moves really quickly. It's not sitting in a warehouse somewhere, not doing much.
Sure.
And then I hopped in one of the rides. It was a nice guy that I met. Turns out we had a lot of people in common. Paul Joseph, big shout out. Check out his band, Metrosonics. Good talent there too. I got to listen to his music and meet his drummer, who is from Rockaway. So we got to see him too. And, they're soldiering down there. They're hanging in there.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so I decided that, I came, I'd done some work there, but I wanted to get to see what else is needed. I didn't get to do any clearing or anything once I got there, but we were just busy delivering.
Oh, no. Oh, I think we've lost him. We'll try to get him back. We'll take a short break and see if we can get him back. Okay, stand by. We're going to be right back with you. We're going to take a short break. And let's see. Well, I wanted to give a shout out while I'm on the air to the people at the Clock Bar. The Clock Bar is on Lincoln Avenue and Brooklyn Boulevard. And really nice bar and cafe. If you want to go for a Sunday brunch, they have unlimited drinks for a certain price. And we can't quote no prices here. But so it's the Clock Bar. It's really nice. And I want to shout out to Alicia Saladin, who's over at the Clock Bar. And they're going to present a beauty bar. Let's see. I don't have. Oh, yes, I do. That's Thursday, November 15th from 7:30 to 9:30 p.m. And that's going to be over at the Clock Bar. And as I said, that's on the corner of Lincoln Avenue and Bruckner Boulevard. And so you should check that out. Those of you that live in the Bronx, even those of you that don't live in the Bronx, you should check that out. Alicia Saladin is a real, real good person. Very hospitable. Okay, so I think we have Louis back on the line. Louis, where were you?
Yep, I'm right here.
Okay, we'll start where you were left off.
Okay, where did I get cut off? Did I start with a supply list?
Yeah, go right into it.
Okay, so things that are needed for donations, aside from if you're not in the area, you can't get here, but you want to help out, you go to OccupySandy.org, and you can make monetary donations there, but you can also go on to, it's a little tweak on the idea of wedding registries. So they've started a wedding registry where you can buy wedding gifts for Occupy Sandy, who's marrying Occupy Sandy, basically. It's done through Amazon.com, so they sell all kinds of stuff that are needed, and they've made a list of different supplies that are necessary right now. So that's something you can do if you're far away or you can't get to a donation site or you're really busy and it doesn't fit into your schedule. We still want to hear from you. But otherwise, if you have blankets, candles, flashlights or lanterns, and batteries to power them, drinking water and food is still important. Obviously, non-perishables for food, but if you want to get involved, you're a caterer, you're a cook, you like to do that kind of work. There are also people who are making hot meals and getting them delivered out there. If you can just cook, but you don't have a vehicle, get in touch, because that's something else you can do, right? And then babies' needs, diapers and wipes, gloves and masks for cleanup, winter boots and rubber boots. One thing I mentioned earlier, but I think I've gotten cut off, is to not donate any more regular clothing right now, because they have a lot of that already.
Mm-hmm.
But winter gear, jackets, hats, gloves, all that is really important, as well as footwear.
Mm-hmm.
then for cleanup, you know, when the main tool that's going to be needed, shovels, contractor-grade trash bags, cleaning supplies and bleach. And for all these hot meals that we're trying to get together, we need dishes, utensils. There's no dishwashing facilities or anything. So paper goods and that type of thing, too.
Right.
And anything that produces heat, from those chemical packs that are hand warmers or foot warmers to, you know, if you have any kind of heater that doesn't rely on electricity, or sometimes that does rely on electricity because some people are getting power back but not heat or have generators.
Now, now tell me, Louis, what does it look like out there in the Far Rockaways? I know they're isolated. There's a bay and the ocean at between them, right?
Well, it's a thin strip of land, very low, very close to sea level. So the whole thing, not just the shoreline, but the whole thing got flooded, several feet of water. The makeup of the Rockaways is very diverse as well, where you have some areas that are really mansions. You know, I saw things. We went over by the beach in the Beach 100s. There are houses that are 3 and 4 stories tall with white columns out front. It looks like something from Gone with the Wind.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and others that don't look like that, but those are really striking, obviously, especially this far north. And you also see a lot of public housing and a lot of one-story bungalows and two-story wooden houses. So it's a big mix. There's a lot of working folks and a lot of wealthier folks that all live there. And everything is washed out, first of all. There are no lights, but by now there are generators on many intersections with halogen lights. So it's lit up in patches, in areas.
Mm-hmm.
It is, like I said, very disorienting when you realize that you're in the place you've been before and it doesn't look the same.
Gotcha.
We did see a lot of traffic cops at all the intersections with the red lights, and I didn't see a single accident, so they're doing a good job.
Okay.
We did see National Guard, but I didn't see any on foot. All they seemed to be doing was guarding petroleum, which I guess comes out of habit.
That's what I was going to ask you about next. What was the National Guard doing out there? Yeah.
Right. So, yeah, they were escorting tankers, and people are fueling up directly from the tankers because even if you have gasoline in an underground tank, the pumps aren't going to be running. So that was, you know, something that folks need as well.
Okay.
What else? I don't know. Well, that's one organization I wanted to plug, and they're really doing good work, and they're responding right away. People are able to place calls to them from the affected areas and put in a request for different types of supplies, and then those orders are filled. Everything is dependent on volunteers being able to drive the stuff down, too. So that's another thing that, especially during the week, they've had a shortage of vehicles available.
Okay.
So if you have a vehicle and you can steal a few hours during the week or on the weekend, please get in touch with them. The weekend, obviously, more people are going to be freed up from the areas that are business as usual, and, you know, 9-to-5s are going to let you go for a couple of days, and you're able to do more. So on weekends, they're also more likely, tomorrow and Sunday and Monday, they're more likely to be able to get work crews together at the assembly points, at the volunteer points that I mentioned earlier, and you'll be able to catch a ride into Staten Island, into the Rockaways, to go and shovel out basements or to clean up or to send to people directly. Sometimes people, just like at the shelters, just need somebody to talk to who hasn't been through the same hell they have.
Okay.
And it's refreshing.
Okay,
so, you know,
Louis,
it's not just physical labor.
Gotcha. Okay. How long are you going to be doing this? What's the need? What's the need assessment?
How long am I going to be doing this?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think I'm going to quit because this isn't going to fix itself. And, you know, we can probably expect the news to stop talking about it a lot sooner than the problems will go away. But, you know, being in Harlem, you can't tell what happened. You know, it was sunny today. It was nice. You know, you're wearing a sweater and you're happy. And it seems like Sandy hit a long time ago. It's really not that long, especially when you lost everything that was in your house. Some of the houses that were by the beach were turned into matchsticks. Everything was just completely smashed.
Okay.
So the first row of houses are just gone.
Gotcha.
So, you know, folks will not just get back on their feet instantly. Or if they do, that's all they have, their own feet. So, you know, we should definitely keep an eye on them and their needs and not forget that this happened just a few miles downtown. Right.
Okay. It's not. Give us contact information, Louis.
All right. So once again, OccupySandy.org is the main website, and from there you can see a lot of the different ways you can get involved. And the phone number, one of the contact people at the Sunset Park Center, which again is Jacoby Church on 54th and 4th in Sunset. Phone number that's listed for them is 347-470-4192. You can also get text updates. If you text Occupy Sandy to the number 23559. And that will keep you kind of clued in. Part of what they're doing, too, if you drive and you want to volunteer, is sending out messages about which gas station has gas and there isn't a long line. So that might be, that's a nice little perk as well. Right. And then another organization I wanted to shout out as well, which has been doing a lot of community work for many, many years, is CAV, C-triple-A-V.
Right. And
what's
that?
Organizing Asian communities. They do a lot of work in the North Bronx and in Chinatown itself.
Okay.
And Chinatown was also hit pretty badly.
Yeah, yeah.
So they were there from before the storm. They're located at 46 Hester Street. And CAAAV.org. Phone number is 212-473-6485. And you can reach them there. They'll be there for the weekend. You can drop supplies there as well on Sunday. And, you know, there's a lot of work to be done. So if you can physically be there and stick around for a few hours, it's definitely needed as well. And like I said, they've been going house to house and checking on their folks and, you know, making sure that nobody gets lost in the cracks and nobody gets forgotten and nobody gets sick or dies unnecessarily.
Gotcha.
Because the storm is only one time you could really get sick or die.
Sure.
You know, it's like this aftermath is also pretty important.
Right.
And they also have a list of needs. Things like baby food, water, milk, whether it's regular, powdered, evaporated. If you get regular milk, smaller containers, half a gallon or less, please. Soy milk, Pediasure, Ensure, Glucerna, formula, canned goods, sources of protein, so things like nuts, cereal bars, applesauce, diapers, again, lights and batteries, especially C and D size batteries, peanut butter, sliced bread, fruit, disposable hand warmers, cleaning supplies, and one specific need they have as well is dry ice for their cooling needs because they're storing medicines like insulin, and without coolers, without having those things cool, that's going to spoil and it's going to be no good. So there are diabetics and there are folks who need to keep their medicine chilled, or they have no medicine. So even if you have access to, you know, medical supplies, that's another need that they've specifically mentioned. And they've always done really good work, and they're really living up to themselves now.
Okay, Louis, I want to thank you for the update. And, you know, are you out there now?
No, I'm not. I'm in Inwood. But that's I'm still doing storm recovery up here, too. And, you know, right on the river, there's I belong to a boathouse,
right,
a canoe club. And we got smashed pretty badly.
Yeah.
Nowhere near as badly as anything else. It's all repairable, but it's worked. You know?
I thought I heard the wind blowing in the background. But, okay, listen, I want to thank you for sharing that with us. And we'll be back in touch with you, and you take care of yourself and your family, okay?
All right. Everyone take care of themselves. Thanks a lot for having me on. Goodbye.
No problem. Okay, there you have it. Louis Lopez, he's in Inwood now, but has been doing some time out there in Far Rockaways doing relief work. And those of us who are in the sound of my voice, who, like you said, have vehicles or have a way to get out to the Rockaways, your help might be, you know, your help can be used. And you know, the people out there are still trying to recover We were lucky being on the high ground that, you know, we escaped a lot of the devastation. But that doesn't mean that we will always be as fortunate as we were this time. You know, we could lose power and, you know, have some problems in our area as well. So what I'm saying, I guess, is to be prepared, to be as prepared as you can be, and you can never be too prepared. And so this should be a wake-up call to us. At this point, we can't say like we did in Irene, oh, well, it, you know, it happened and it wasn't that bad or whatever. I mean, this thing had some devastating and damaging effects in certain parts of the area, especially in the low-lying areas and in New Jersey. So it behooves us to be prepared. We're going to take a break, and then we're going to come right back. I think we're going to be hopefully talking with Minister Hafiz, Abdul Hafiz Muhammad from Mosque No. 7 here in the Village of Harlem. So stay right there.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
This is Maurice Watts, better known as The Voice, and your radio host of The Love Zone, reminding you that this Friday night, I need you to stop on by my place, The Love Zone, from 8 p.m. until the stroke of midnight. Well, you will hear some of the best R&B love songs of today and yesteryear. That's right, we take you from 1948 and bring you all the way up to the present, baby. Been serving you your love for over 22 long years. So hey, mark your calendar. This Friday at 8, you and I have a date. I'll see you there. For each other.
Can you imagine waking up to a phone call telling you that your child was killed? How about seeing your little cousin lying in the street with a gunshot wound? Or reading in a daily paper that the star basketball player in your school was shot and killed? When young children and teenagers die without getting the chance to experience life, it not only affects parents, it affects us all. Violence in the city of New York has been on the rise for too long because our youth lack opportunities. Kids hanging on the street corners in Harlem need alternatives, like job trainings. So help become a solution. Join Street Corner Resources. Street Corner Resources is at the forefront in helping to eliminate gun and gang violence. They also provide education, employment training, and other resources to the community. For more information on how you can join or support Street Corner Resources, visit streetcornerresources.org. Don't allow children to fail. Allow them to choose.
We're back with you, and we are going to take some time to talk with somebody who was affected, someone who was affected by the storm, by Sandy, directly. We just finished speaking with Louis Lopez, who is doing some relief work out in the Rockaways, and now we're going to be talking with Minister Abdul Hafiz Muhammad from Muhammad Mosque number 7 here in Harlem, the national representative for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. Assalamu alaikum, Brother Minister.
Wa alaikum assalam to you, Brother Hodja. How are you this evening? And greetings to the Harlem 411 family.
Thank you so much, sir. Okay, I guess we'll start. Where are you located, first of all? And then tell us how you've been affected by this storm.
Well, I'm out in Suffolk County, Long Island, and we're on a high ground where it's not a flood area, but we're affected by trees like anyone else, like they are in Westchester County or in Queens.
Mm-hmm.
And the problem is that the frustration with Long Island Power Authority is shared with the governor because it doesn't make any sense. LIPA has cut power in a lot of places that were not totally devastated. They had trees down. They had them on lines, but the lines were not broke in the name of protecting themselves. But then they leave you stranded and don't come back and rectify the situation. And so with the nor'easter that came on Wednesday, further delayed any word being kept, and word wasn't being kept anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So the frustration that Governor Cuomo has, we can say, in this juncture, as the political leader of the state, we agree with that Long Island Power Association, along with other energy agencies, have not kept their word. See, the people's money spend very well. They cash it on your debit card. They cash it off your credit card. They cash your check, or they take your cash at the counter. But they have not kept their word to be able to restore. They say that they are tens of thousands of crews that are working out there and from other places, and you see all of the tree trucks moving the trees, but you don't see no power coming back. You know, and so whether it's the grids or the lines that you're on, you know, everything, and it's not about you personally because there are other people suffering.
Sure.
When I called up, they said, do you know that there are 1,900 other people like you who are suffering? And I'm concerned about them as I hope they're concerned about me, but I don't know them and they don't know me. So I have to call for me. And if me calling for me gets their power back on, then so be it.
Sure, sure.
You know, and so, you know, it can be a frustrating situation. But the beautiful thing is that because of the teachings of Dr. Elijah Muhammad, we prepare ourselves for these situations. And we're not always prepared to the best, you know. But by the grace of God, you know, we're able to get through it a lot easier than most.
How well prepared were you, Brother Minister?
Well, we understood that we needed to have flashlights and floodlights, and we know we needed to have two-way radios so that we could still communicate and pick up the news that was floating in the air. And we know we needed to have sterno cans, and we needed to have the pans by which to heat, because there would still be water, though it would be cold, but once you heat it up, you're able to still make your coffee or your tea or cook your meals or make your bean soup or whatever it may be. You know, we needed to have a lot of blankets around. At a certain point, the cold can be so brutal as it was that you can't stay in a cold place, and so you have to seek refuge as best you can, you know. But, you know, at least if you had your home and it wasn't destroyed, that was a great blessing. If it was partially destroyed, that was one. But if it was totally destroyed, you still have a blessing because you have yourself.
Yes, sir.
And the frustration is you don't have your belongings or the place where you once dwelled. But those things ultimately can be replaced. But you can't replace a human life once it's gone.
Yes. What is your situation right now, Brother Minister?
Say that again.
What is your situation right now?
Oh, we're still without power, going on 11 days.
11 days.
And don't know when power will be restored, you know.
What are some of the things that you've learned in terms of coping that you might give to the listening audience, those who are in the preparedness business or who need to be prepared?
Well,
and stuff.
The first thing is don't beat people down who are not prepared. You know, there was a man one day who was urinating up against the mosque, and some of the companions of the prophet were going to beat the man for disrespecting the house of God. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, don't beat the savage, teach him. See? Show him a better way. In other words, the Minister Farrakhan said, offer them to come in where you use the facilities at. See? And be respectful. So there are many of our people who took her Hurricane Sandy, which is really God himself, for granted. But when the meteorologist is telling you it's coming for a direct hit, it's not going out to the Atlantic, then you have to be wiser. If you're told to evacuate by the officials wisely, then evacuate. And if you're told that no one will be able to come help you because they can't risk their lives, because they have to be the responders after the disaster, then be wise. We also have to realize is that our people still need to be trained, and we have to go about it. But if we scare them with paranoia when they're already going through a disaster, and if we beat them down because they didn't do it, that's not the proper way to get people to be able to respond in this matter. Because what happened with Hurricane Sandy and the nor'easter that was supposed to just be rain, 1 to 2 inches of rain brought, in some areas, 3 to 4 inches of snow. In other areas, 2 to 3 inches. So, and then ice later on. Though the sun came the next day, which generally happens, and it moved things away as though it didn't exist. In other places, it still have the remnants of it. The bottom line is, we were shocked once again. And so if you have a home, you know, yes, you need to get a generator, but you need to know how the generator needs to operate. Because many people, Brother Hodger, have lost their lives. Others are in the hospital because they have the generators too close to their home. The generator has to be at least 25 feet away from your home. And it has to be set up in such a way that you are not ill affected by its running and operation. If there's smoke coming from it, then that generator is not operating properly. You have to determine whether or not gasoline is better for you or gas. Some say gas is better because there's always there on the propane tank. And some say gasoline. You saw that New York now is landlocked for gas. Because when the storm hit, the Midtown Tunnel was closed down with 11 feet of water, 8 million gallons of water had to be pumped out of the Queens Midtown Tunnel. Battery Tunnel shut down. Holland Tunnel shut down. Lincoln Tunnel shut down. GW Bridge shut down. Throsnick shut down. Triborough shut down. New York was shut down. So now we have to now, when you're going home at night, you know, we were always taught in the nation, fill up your tank with gas. So that if you have to wake up the next morning, you can at least drive 4 hours on the road. That's the way I was trained. So I did fill up my car with gas. So I didn't have to worry about gas. And when if I had to make a journey and get down the road, I was able to get down that road until I was able to get somewhere where they were not as affected with the gas shortage as we were in New York City. You know? If we're living in apartment buildings, many of our people are suffering and our people are up on the high floors. See, what we have to realize now is that those that are on that South Shore, those that are in those Rockaways and 17 floors up and 16 floors up and other than that, that we know the next time we have to evacuate our elderly. We can't leave them. Because and we have to find out, why did the generators fail? Were there backup generators in New York City Housing Authority? And with all the money they get in NYSHA, why don't they have backup generators? Why are they not investing in that? You know what I mean? And I mean, they can get flooded like NYU Hospital. Remember, they had backup generators. But 8 feet of water filled up in their basement, which flooded up the generators, which is what the Honorable Muhammad said. He said, I can teach you how to prepare for the famine of your enemy. I can teach you how to prepare for something unfortunate. But if God sends something on us, then you can't prepare for that, because God comes in and floods out everything that you have. And at that moment, you have to be blessed just to be alive and to survive so that you can be here, you know, for the next event.
You know, they're talking about, I've been listening to the reports of late, and they're talking about how this these two storms, Irene and Sandy, almost back-to-back, how they affected us, and the fact that they, you know, because of the climate changes, storms that, you know, ordinarily happen once in 100 years and stuff will be happening, you know, once every 10 years or more. And they're talking about, you know, preparing for such cases, you know, as that. They're also talking about, there was an article in the Nation magazine that talked about, we are all from New Orleans, you know, with regard to the Katrina situation.
Oh, yes. People are recognizing, Brother Hodger, that as our people were in 2005, left out there, see, left alone. Now we're all getting a bit of taste of this. Allah says in the Quran, be careful of the chastisement that will not affect the unjust only, but it will touch the just person. Mm. It will touch the good people as well. Mm-hmm. You see what I'm saying? The righteous will be touched. But if our lives are spared, we have to be very thankful in that regard. Now, Brother Hodges, we humbly submit that this God is using global warming. God is angry with America. And Minister Farrakhan talked about this at the 17th anniversary of the Million Man March. Mm. He said, I told you year after year to watch the weather.
Watch the weather.
It was Minister Farrakhan who said in the last, we had 10 years of bad weather that was coming on America that you have never seen before. We're in that period right now. And it's getting worse each time. So when Governor Cuomo said, as much as I want to believe it won't happen again, he says, I know that it will happen again. As much as I want to pray for it not to happen, he says, I know that it's going to happen. So New York State and America has to reorganize how we prepare for that which has taken 80 to 100 years, now happens every 2 years. And let's be honest, this happened within a year's time.
That's right.
Because you just had Irene last year.
Mm-hmm.
So we're within a year's time of Irene from last winter to this winter. Now we have Sandy and a nor'easter off the North Atlantic waters. You know, and more are coming, We haven't even got through the winter season yet, Brother Hodges. So what we're going to have to do now is be able to learn how to bunker down in our homes. Those who have homes have to appropriately put up the right kind of panels, run their generators, determine whether it's going to be gasoline or propane. If it's going to be gas, you can't store gas as long as you can store propane tanks because gas will evaporate. And where will you put it at? If you're in a condo, then you have to look at the backup systems and where those systems are. Like in New Orleans, when I toured the Ninth Ward and the wards where the flooding took place, the homes now are built 2 and 3 feet off the ground to compensate for the rise of the water level. See, so that the home is not ill-affected. So everyone has to look different at disaster preparedness. Like the Caribbean, they build the homes out of concrete, not out of wood, because they want to make sure that it can withstand the strong winds that come by. And our people suffered in Jamaica. They suffered in Cuba. They suffered in the Bahamas. They suffered in Bermuda. And nearly, I think, 16 or 20 deaths took place there. You see? But you do the best you can. And in Cuba, they know how to evacuate you all the way to the other side of the island where the hurricane may not hit that side. You see? So an example in America, it hit all along the south shores. You see? Everybody got the strong winds of Sandy, 65 to 85 miles per hour. But the south shores and Long Beach and Far Rockaway, Queens and Breezy Point, see? And even some on the Connecticut border got hit very, very hard. And of course, the most terrible hit was in New Jersey, in Atlantic City, and everything on that southern border in Cape May got direct hit. Fire Island, out on Long Island and stuff, I mean, just got destroyed, buried underwater. The homes are gone. So we now have to understand that being in where we are there is not going to be good, because God says in the Quran that he will curtail you on all of your sides. And Allah Muhammad says that America will be curtailed on all of her sides, and she will be pushed into the middle of the country. So we have to even think now when these things are coming. Because let me say this to you, Brother Hodges. I live on Long Island, like millions of others. And it's a nice place to be. But and where we are is not a flood zone. But we could be hit with a hurricane. Don't you know if I hear that hurricane whatever is coming, let's say it's hurricane whatever is coming at Long Island, I'm gone, brother. I'm coming where you are. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to be sitting there talking about worrying about no house and belongings. We're going to take what's necessary, get our gold bag, and that's beyond a 72-hour bag.
Yes, sir.
We're going to be gone.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You know, so we have to use wisdom in an hour like this.
Yeah, I agree, Brother Minister. And you know, one of the things I was wondering is, will the nation, will the mosque be gearing up, be even revving up their training, emergency preparedness, and you know, solidifying that network?
Yes.
Can you
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
We were affected by this like anyone else. Many of our believers, their homes, their basements took in 4 to 5 feet of water.
Mm-hmm.
Many of our believers lost all of their belongings. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
They lost vehicles. We were affected. Trees fell on homes and, you know, so we were affected right along with everyone else and needed to recover. You know, we're sitting here without power. You see what I'm saying? It's not a nice thing. Your house is cold and you got to go in and you want to go in and do business or go in and get some things, right? But your home is freezing.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't stay in it for so long.
Mm-hmm.
But thankful to wonderful believers in our community,
mm-hmm.
then our doors have been open where others can be able to take shelter
mm-hmm.
away from what is happening.
Mm-hmm.
So you may be suffering, but someone else may not be in the same condition you are. So
sure.
we've been asked by those in our community to teach and train our people. But one, we must remind and prepare them why these things are happening.
Mm-hmm.
And we must also then not leave them with paranoia or fear and not beat them down, but
mm-hmm.
give them the guidance and direction that they need, my dear brother.
Yes, sir.
And we also, and so I'm happy to hear of the many brothers and sisters who've been helping our brothers and sisters in Far Rockaway. We had to evacuate some of our own family members from over in those areas.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm happy to see others coming together.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? And come and tying their ropes together, as Minister Farrakhan said, to be able to aid and help one another.
Mm-hmm. You know,
so the nation will participate
sure.
along with others
when
in disaster preparedness teaching.
Sure.
We want all of us who do it, nation or other than the Nation of Islam, other community groups, just don't do it with paranoia and scare tactics because the people are suffering.
Right.
You know what I mean? And if you were going through what they were going through, then there's no need to be acting in that fashion with one another.
Sure.
You know, have poise, have calm. Yeah, there's a sense of urgency. But as long as we every day above ground, I always say every day above ground is indeed a blessed day. As long as you're above the ground, then you have time to solve that problem.
Mm-hmm. In addition to what you've been saying, you know, among the things that we learned, I learned in my family, we opened up our home. You know, we talked about being on the high ground. You know, in terms of being here in Harlem, being on the high ground, and you know, and we were fortunate. So the thing is that we opened up, you know, our home to, you know, to people who might have been without homes, who had lost their homes, you know, they're in the low-lying areas and stuff. And we put out a call, you know, if you needed a place to lay your head, we were available. We gathered
Indeed.
Our neighbors around doing the first day of the storm. We gathered our neighbors around and we had a meal in our home. And now we're collecting, you know, goods and things like that to send to places like Rockaway and stuff. So there, even where you are, you can do, you know, you can be helpful if you're blessed in that regard to still
retain life. And this is where, Brother Harvey, that's a beautiful expression of an act of kindness that should be done. And now you have to watch as well as pray.
Mm-hmm.
And those that we bring into our homes,
exactly.
I remember Katrina when the minister wanted us, the believers, to open up their homes.
Mm-hmm.
And he told us to be watchful at the same time.
Exactly.
You needed to be mindful who you were bringing in.
Exactly.
But when it's people that you know and they're suffering, you have a knowledge, then you know you can be more relaxed. You know what I mean? Because it is your home and you still wanted to be that way when things return to normal. You know, so those are acts of kindness. I'm at the benefit of that right now, me and my family. Brother that I've known over 30 years and would have never known. As a matter of fact, I offered my home to another believing family who lost power. And then I lose power and had to be taken in by another family. And see, that's how that goes around, you know.
Yes.
And so what goes around indeed does come around.
Okay.
And so those kind of acts of kindness should always be employed wherever we can do so. But notice what you said. You were blessed to be in high ground, and you will be able to take other people in.
Right.
We've got to remember when these storms come, we have to get to a place of safety. But this is the point that I wanted to say, and I thank Allah he brought it back to me. This is when those who have need to help those who don't have.
Exactly.
Directly on the ground.
We're going to take...
when, you know, and I'm not just saying the rich, but those who have more than others come and actually make substantive change. This is when whatever the city has, and if you know the city's broke, but you know you've got millions of sitting, then you make sure you come and help people.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Okay, go ahead, brother. We just had to take a station ID.
No problem. But we want to make sure that people are not living in substandard conditions.
Mm-hmm.
Because you give someone shelter, but the shelter is dirty. Can't we come in and clean it up?
Yes, sir.
Can't we come in and bring them a respectable cot to sleep on?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and one thing that Governor Cuomo did that I looked at, when they brought in the pounds of food, thousands upon thousands of pounds of food that came in off a truck. It was him, Sheldon Silver, and Nydia Velasquez. And the governor didn't look right when he said, I don't know, well, at least he was being honest. He said, but I don't know what the food that I'm giving you, what it tastes like.
Mm.
But we know that it's here to be able to help you.
See, right.
What would have been good? Whatever you're going to give someone else?
Yes, sir.
It comes from a creed that we have as Muslims. When you want for your brother and sister that which you want for yourself.
Mm. Mm.
So why give people food that you really didn't want to have?
Right.
I look at the board president and the email they sent, along with the controller and another political wing here in New York City, and they were giving out fruit. They were giving out cheese. They were giving out crackers. I think they were giving something out that they didn't sit and eat, full of protein. You see what I'm saying?
Sure.
But to give people something that you don't even know.
Right.
Brother, like, and you don't even want to taste it yourself.
Yes.
It's just not a good thing. It's like you're giving them government cheese.
We have a caller. We have a caller, a brother minister, I think, on the line. Did you want to take some questions?
Yes,
no
sir.
Problem.
Okay. Yes, sir. Who's on the line?
Brother George from Harlem.
Brother George from Harlem. Okay.
Walaikum Salaam.
Well, sir, what's going on today? The messenger spoke about this years ago. I remember when the old mosque was there at 116th Street.
He said,
these years that's coming, you must stock up with canned goods, flashlights. Those that have closets, empty one of your closets and fill it up with security. That's back in the 60s.
Mm.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, brother.
Mm-hmm.
He told us what the store in our houses and what foods to eat, my brother.
That's true.
And that's the same thing that the minister is warning us today, but the minister, on his behalf, has taken it to another level of letting us know that these kinds of storms and hurricanes are going to increase. And if we know it now, and we do know it, we now must prepare ourselves much better than we have.
Brother George.
Now we know that we can have a shortage of gas now. See, there's other realities that we didn't think about before. Now, when you go home, you need to fill your tank up. You see what I'm saying? Don't leave it on E, riding around on the ether. We're all going to think a little bit differently now after Hurricane Sandy than the way we did before.
Brother George, how did you prepare for the storm?
I always have what's needed in the house with my family, always.
Yes, sir.
Time to time, when I get a chance, I walk around the community, those plastic bags with the coupons and stuff. I get 15 bags of coupons, and I come home and clip them out. And now you can use them.
Yes,
that's right, brother.
Yes,
you store up your water. You
yes,
store up
sir.
Those essential things. You store up those essential foods of protein,
mm-hmm.
you know, that the soldiers use, that you can also have. Because you, at a certain point, you might not be able to cook, you see. But if you get the Sterno cans, you can do so, you know. But if you don't have any, you know, but you can get this little hot plate, you know, and fire it up with propane. So it's about what Brother George is saying, what we're saying together. It's about what you put aside for a day and a moment like this that can get you by.
Okay. Well, we are about ready to to close this segment. And
Brother George still on the line?
Brother George, you're still there.
Yes, I am.
Brother George, how you doing, brother? I pray you come out with us this Sunday at the mosque.
Sunday at 2 o'clock?
Sunday at 11 a.m.
11, thank you, sir.
All right, from 11 to 1, our subject is going to be guidance in the time of trouble.
Thank you.
Right on 127th Street in Harlem. Thank you, my brother.
Well, all right.
Well, thank you, Salam, Brother George. Thank you for calling. Brother Minister, we run out of time here.
Indeed.
But I am glad that you and your family are well and that you have been able to weather the storm. And I know that God will watch over you and maintain you. So until the next time, hopefully we'll be talking on a better note, but always being watchful, as you said, being prepared, always
indeed,
being
my
watchful.
Brother. And as long as we're above ground, brother, the note is always good. It may be frustrating, may be trying, but every day above ground is indeed a blessed day. Another day to solve a problem and another day to receive a wonderful blessing.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Brother Hodger.
You take the best of care. Walaikum
salam.
Peace be unto you. Yes, sir. There you have it. We just talked with Minister Abdul Hafiz from Mosque Number 7. And, you know, we talked about preparedness. The storm has passed, but there is still so much devastation. There are people that are recovering. And so we need to be aware of that. And if you are if you have been blessed enough to be able to have weathered this and not come out with too much damage or anything, think about those who are suffering this evening, who are shivering and cold and who don't have power and don't have their lights restored, can't use the elevators because the electricity is down. So think about others who are going through changes right now and might not be as fortunate as yourself, and try to do something that will help somebody other than yourself. So we just want to thank you, the listening audience, for being out there. We missed you. We missed you during the week that we were down. Want to thank Tina Dixon, especially, and Black Icon for the report that they gave. I think it was on Monday or Tuesday. And in regard, they did a really good job, I thought. And we just stay right there. Don't go nowhere. Kaziah Glow is coming up with her guest, and she's going to have something good for you. So listen in.
Us down, but now it looks like things are finally coming around. I know we've got a long, long way to go, and where we'll end up, I don't know. But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're putting our show together, we're polishing up our act. And if you've ever been held down before, I know you refuse to be held down anymore. Well,
don't you let nothing stand in your way.
I want you to listen
to every word I say, every word I say.
Ain't no stopping us now.
We're on the move.
And if you're trying to make it, they only push you aside. They really don't have nowhere to go. Ask them where they're going, they don't know.
But we won't let nothing hold us back. We're gonna put our show together, we're gonna polish up our act. Well, and if you've ever been held down before, I know
nothing
stand in your way.
All right, welcome back. We are back in the studio after the storm. We made it through. We did. We did. And I have my special guest. I have Isarene. She's in the studio, Sister Isarene. And she is a holistic guru. I know she's going to say, oh, don't put that pressure on me. But she's changed her life by changing the way you eat, the way you think. The work that you're doing, you're really working on the water, the alkaline waters, the essential oils, and it's
therapeutic grade essential oils.
Therapeutic grade, food grade, yes. Essential oils. And when I see the pictures of your before and afters, mm-hmm. this is not something that you're like selling, like you fell into and you said, oh, I could sell this and I could make some money off of this.
It's not a game.
I see the difference. I've mm-hmm. seen it in your pictures, and anyone who wants to be your friend on Facebook. And your name is?
Isarene, E-Y-E, Serene, S-E-R-E-N-E.
Right.
And I also have a page, Young Living Essential Oils in Bedford-Stuyvesant, Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like me.
Like her.
Friend me, like
And why are we talking about this today? After the storm, after all the stuff that we've been through, we see how important our health is because everything is just so fragile and things hang on by a strand. You know, you one minute you're here, the next minute you're not. Mm-hmm. And when these things happen, we have to be strong enough to deal with them. We have to be strong enough to sometimes go without food, to sometimes go without things. Yeah. So we have to fortify our bodies when we can.
I got a quick story.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we were just discussing our last conversation and I told you that I got a piece of glass stuck in my finger.
Right.
So just imagine a scenario. If I were in a situation where the storm affected me, I couldn't get to the doctor, I couldn't get to the hospital, the essential oils sustained me.
Wow.
So I got a piece of glass stuck in my finger.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that it came out. I stopped the bleeding. I went on with my life. A month and a half later, it wasn't healing.
Mm.
That's scary.
Right.
Right. You know, body's supposed to be able to regenerate.
Mm-hmm.
So I realized, pressing on it, that there was glass in my finger.
Mm.
I'm currently unemployed. Mm-hmm. I do not have health care.
Like a lot of people.
Exactly. So right. What am I supposed to do? I started studying. What essential oils do I have that can draw out infection?
Mm.
And I started to use these essential oils. And when you address a cut, you cannot just address it topically. That is Western medical thinking. You have to address the whole body. So I started to take essential oils internally. I had to do some fasting, a lot of water, a lot of juicing, fresh vegetables, and it took exactly 5 days.
Wow.
On a hard regimen. And the day the infection burst out of my finger, the night before, I went for infrared sauna treatment.
Mm.
And the next morning I woke up from applying the oils topically, oregano, thyme, lemongrass, geranium, and lavender. They're very those are two very gentle oils. The oregano, the thyme, those are hardcore. You got to be ready for that. But that next morning after that infrared sauna, when you get that deep tissue treatment, all this pus is coming out my finger. And this could have turned serious. This little cuts like this can lead to losing your finger.
Interesting enough, you're saying the pus was coming out your finger, right. But it probably was coming out of other parts of your
exactly.
body that you don't even know.
Exactly.
You mentioned the herb thyme, but mm-hmm. thyme, some people say, I don't have the time to do this.
Mm-hmm.
How can I find the time? You know, I need a quick fix because I don't got time for this.
It has to be your lifestyle. Your business has to be you. That was the decision that I finally had to make. There is no other business but me.
Mm.
There's nothing else to be doing but me. You know, a lot of times I see sisters and they, you know, they do the weight loss. People, brothers, sisters, they do this weight loss thing. And the first thing they want to do after they reach their mark is go back and eat what they were eating.
Right.
That led them there to begin with.
Right.
One of my sisters said to me, girl, I can't wait till we go out and have drinks. I said, drinking what? Water?
Right.
Because that. Eventually you just have to leave that lifestyle alone.
That's the hard part.
Mm-hmm.
That's the hard part, stepping away and saying I'm not on a diet or having a diet mentality.
Changed. You have to just change and you have to maintain that change and you have to be committed. And if you're not committed, then don't commit to it. Don't teeter-totter. That's worse for your body. It's like stretching. It's like contracting excuse me, it's like expanding.
Like a rubber,
a rubber band.
Right.
Exactly.
Going back and forth.
Yeah, you can't do that. You got to just stretch it or leave it alone.
Right.
But the back and forth, that yo-yo, we call it LV in Luther Vandrosen. You can't do that. You can't.
Don't do it to yourself.
You can't do that to yourself.
Now, you mentioned the water, the importance of water. Our bodies are, you know, we always hear we're made up of a lot of water. When the moon is full, we react certain ways. The planet is made up of water. How important is water to us, and how much water, from your research, did you find out we should be drinking per day?
It depends on your body weight. But if you want to compare it to the planet, the planet is 3/4 water.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, I mean, I recommend 3/4 of a gallon to a gallon a day.
Mm.
You know, that's what I recommend to people. And that includes soups. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't mean just drinking water. That includes soups. That includes tea. That includes, you know, smoothies.
Mm.
You know, it's just including it, incorporating it into your food.
Right.
It's not just plain water. You don't just have to do plain water.
What?
And enemas also.
Oh, wow.
If you're dehydrated and you take an enema, your body will not release that. That's how you can tell if you're dehydrated. Your body will hold that. It will never come back out.
You know, I know when I'm dehydrated, my lips turn black.
Uh-huh.
And I get wrinkles in my face.
Uh-huh.
And then when I start drinking water, my lips turn back to the regular color.
Right.
And I'm dehydrated a lot and I don't even realize it.
That's your digestive tract.
Mm-hmm.
It's just crying for it.
Right.
That's your colon. That's your small intestine. That's your liver, your gallbladder. It's just, it needs that. And with these essential oils, I'm realizing also that it doesn't matter if you're dealing in any healing modality. If you're not using water, it's worthless because you need the water to push anything along. So if you're taking herbs and you're not drinking water, the herb isn't going anywhere. It's just sitting in your body. If I'm applying essential oils to my body, but without exercise and circulation, where's it going? It's just boom, dead there, sitting there on my arm.
Right.
But I need the water and I need the circulation to get things actually going. It's a complete system.
Nice.
People have to be dedicated.
You deal with the alkaline water.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about the importance of it, because I hear some people say, well, I don't really know what it is, and you know, just to demystify that whole thing.
Well, a lot of people have good diets and they have an alkaline diet. So, you know, if you eat a lot of greens, you eat a lot of raw greens, if you know that you need to squeeze some lime into your water, if you have a good filter, if you know how to filter your water, you're fine. But I consider the alkaline, the Kangen water machine, I consider it an emergency situation, and I consider most of us in emergency situations.
Mm.
Most of us are very acidic, and it's not just our food, it's our thinking, it's our anger.
It's the way of life. It's just being, well, we have listeners who are outside of the city, of course, and we're grateful for those people, but being in these cities and dealing with the towers, the cell phone towers, there's so much you're bombarded with.
Yes.
You don't even realize.
Right.
So...
Right. So, you know, if you can just try, find a source of alkaline water for just 1 week, you would see a difference. You would notice a difference. You would notice a difference in your thinking, in your breathing, in your energy level, because we're not getting enough oxygen. So,
what?
It's just, you know what? I don't want to sell the machine. Trust me, I want to sell the machine because sister's unemployed. I sell the machine. I am a distributor. But I really do believe that if people start educating themselves and paying attention to their own bodies, they can figure out ways of healing themselves without having to rely on these machines.
Okay.
I gotta say that. I do have a machine. I did invest in a machine, but it is dependent on electricity and I have issues with that.
Mm.
So,
well, see, that goes into when the lights go out.
Exactly. So I have no water when the lights go out unless I filled up.
Right.
So you still have to be educated enough to know how to get clean water, or your immune system has to be so much so that you can maintain for a couple of days.
Right. Speaking of the oxygen that you mentioned in the water, H2O. A lot of times my father will be like going crazy, walking in circles. And I'm like, you know what? You need some more oxygen in your body. Mm-hmm. And your brain is losing oxygen right now. He just looks at me like I'm crazy. But tell us a little bit about that. Like, when we're not feeling well, does water really give our body and our cells oxygen?
Of course. And the brain needs it. And there are essential oils. Frankincense is very important. You know, you have those oils that they talk about in the Bible. And there's a reason why folks were using these oils. Frankincense, myrrh, what's another one that's very oxygen? Actually, all essential oils are oxygenating.
Mm-hmm.
But specifically to the limbic system and the brain and the functioning of the brain. Frankincense, I gotta say, and it's also kills cancer cells. You know, these, I stress the essential oils more than I even stress the alkaline water, because the essential oils, they've been here forever.
Mm-hmm.
This alkaline water machine is a brand new invention.
Right. And then with the essential oils, they're different types of essential oils too.
Right.
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 Some of them are not as potent as others, and you can't ingest all of them.
You can't, and if you can't ingest it, you shouldn't even be touching it. It's not an essential oil.
Right.
Because the nature, how can you have the essential oil of mint, but you can't eat it, but you can eat mint? That just logically doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
So where did this oil come from? If I can't put this mint on my tongue, where this mint come from?
Right.
If this essential oil is orange and it came from an orange and I can eat oranges, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Just the process. You got to think, like, why does this bottle say not edible? So you really have to look for sources of therapeutic grade, food grade essential oils. Again, I'm a distributor of Young Living essential oils.
And if anybody has heard anything and they have questions for you, or they just want to talk to you and, you know, get some more information. I like that you like to talk to people and you like to have these conversations.
I'm very passionate.
Yeah, and you're engaging. How can they reach you?
They can email me, Iserene, Iserene, at ymail.com. Iserene@ymail.com.
Okay, that's good. And also, like, if they've heard something and they don't agree with it, they should...
Oh, please reach out to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I love learning new things, and I'm always down for a good debate.
We love it. We love it. And we look for you on Facebook. And I say go to Iserene on Facebook so you can actually see her before and after pictures. And they're not even like, it's not even like a promo you're doing. You just, I think the last one you said, my waistline something.
Oh, yeah. I said, I had to bring the waistline in, waste.
Yeah, because, and that picture's crazy.
Yeah, that picture is crazy.
How long ago was that?
That's, I guess, 5 years now.
Wow. You look amazing, and you look totally different.
I do look totally different.
Yeah, your skin looks great, too.
Thank you. Thank you. I feel great.
Well, thank you for stopping in.
Yeah, my pleasure. Okay. Anytime.
Yeah, you better bring me some food next time.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
All raw.
Oh, there you go. Okay. There you go. Okay. All right. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. We love you.
Love you, too. Peace.
Okay, peace.
Hey, this is Joseph Hayes inviting you to tune into Another Perspective every Friday from 5 to 6 p.m. Another Perspective is a community affairs show that brings you information, news, solutions, and entertainment, all from another perspective. That's Another Perspective with your host, Henry Portia, Reggie Mitchell, and yours truly, Joseph Hayes. That's every Friday from 5 to 6 p.m. on WHCR 90.3 FM, The Voice of Harlem.
I found out on my way to Harlem.
With today's unpredictable economy, it's become quite strenuous for millions of jobless Americans to keep their heads above water. Yet as strenuous as it is for the average American, what about the formerly incarcerated American? Well, this is just how strenuous it can be. Recent national surveys indicate that the unemployment rate among the formerly incarcerated 1 year after release may be as high as 60%. However, fortunately, there's Fortune Society. For nearly half a century, the Fortune Society has proudly assisted formerly incarcerated men and women in the New York City area. The Fortune Society's initiatives include housing, education, employment, and substance abuse treatment, which have reinvigorated the lives of many. If you or a loved one have recently been released from prison and are actively seeking to fully reintegrate into society, visit FortuneSociety.com for more information.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
All right, welcome back. This is Keziah Glow, and I'm in the studio jacking up. I don't know if you guys heard that last little tidbit. We're having so much fun in the studio. I forgot to turn the mic off. So anyway, I have my guest, Dennis Speed. Hi, Dennis.
Hello.
Hello. That's all we get. So Dennis is a return guest, and we're really happy to have him here today because, you know, he's given us so much information. He gave us the forecast when we before we saw the country go into this economic whirlwind. You've given us so much information that has been helpful. Unfortunately, we only have a half an hour with you, so we really need to be concise. Dennis, what are your thoughts? We just won, and I say we just won because I feel like Obama is in office, and I'm really excited. And, you know, I'm glad his opponent did not win. And I know you're not excited about that. Or are you excited about that? And I want to hear what your thoughts are.
Well, no, my thoughts are basically with the decease of the New York City subway system. That is to say, I just finished riding on the New York City subway system. And, of course, it's been a big issue recently because the subways were flooded.
Right.
And in addition to the subways being flooded, there was a lot of damage along the shoreline and down in Far Rockaway, particularly Staten Island, some of the other areas. And New Jersey, of course, experienced the same thing.
Right.
Estimates are running anything from anywhere from $30 billion to $50 billion as low estimates for the total amount of damage.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what I'm dealing with is the fact that I know that Mayor Bloomberg, who is the mayor of New York and presumably the guardian of the citizens of New York, is worth, net worth, $25 billion.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that Mayor Bloomberg knows because of the American Society of Civil Engineers and other people who did studies about the impending dangers to New York City years ago, that you could have built a flood wall around New York City for $7 billion starting sometime right after 9/11.
Mm-hmm.
All kinds of studies came out saying this and giving the estimates and so on. Well, that wasn't done, and now we have both loss of human life and costs, which will probably total something along the lines of $50 billion because that estimate, that investment wasn't made. And I'm not suggesting that the mayor necessarily had to build the entire subway, flood wall himself.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, after all, there's also Warren Buffett, there are all kinds of other people that the mayor is familiar with.
A lot of his friends.
And as J. Paul Getty once said, if you can count your money, you don't have $1 billion.
Mm-hmm.
The mayor could have literally taken $7.5 billion of his money, had $18 billion left, would have gotten tax breaks for the money he would have, in fact, given, built the flood wall, and not have ever felt it. So what's interesting is that he was nonetheless insistent that the marathon get run,
mm-hmm.
until it became clear that some of the marathon runners might have ended up getting injured by some of the people that were going to be in the neighborhoods that they were going to be going through, like running over the dead bodies of the people down in Staten Island, for example, as one person put it. And I'm saying this to say something about the quality of mind that I believe presently occupies public office generally in the United States. Bloomberg is one example of that. Christie is a different example, a man that just before election night is put on the phone by President Barack Obama with Bruce Springsteen, and he's governor, of course, of New Jersey, Christie, and he nearly breaks down in tears because his hero has gotten on the phone with him, and then there's a discussion about how this proves that Obama deserves the Nobel Peace Prize because he put Springsteen and Christie on the phone. And Springsteen, of course, is no Christie fan. That's a good joke. But the quality of leadership that we have in office is somewhat short of sanity. I truly believe that what we have entered is an age in which you have a lot of people in office that are just crazy. To the point that we're being told that global warming is the reason that the city got flooded, but there are studies done 9-10 years ago saying that this storm would occur.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you believed that, you should have done something about it.
Right. Unless you wanted it to
unless
happen.
You wanted that to occur. Now, there's an interesting thing about this, because the people that really got hit down in New Jersey, for example, yes, there were people with summer homes along the shore, but there's a whole lot of working poor people that have lived down on those shore areas ever since really the 1920s and 30s. Matter of fact, what they're living in is winterized bungalows. What they were living in was winterized bungalows. Until a lot of those got washed into the middle of Highway 35, Route 35, down there along that the shore area where, you know, Perth Amboy and some of those other areas are west of that area. And so the fundamental concern I have is that when you have that degree of divorcement from reality, it's possible under those circumstances, and generally under those circumstances, it's possible that war breaks out because people who are desperate to avoid these kinds of problems turn to war as a solution, which is very much like the Roman arena. That's what they do. And I think that if you ask me what I think has happened, I'm not happy about Obama being elected. I believe Obama is just as crazy as Christie is, which is as crazy as Bloomberg.
Mm-hmm.
I think you've entered an age in which people like the people that we know from history from the Roman Empire, whether we're talking about Caligula or Nero or we're talking about Tiberius, these kind of people. That's who we now have governing.
Mm.
And I believe that the people have an additional problem because, you know, there was a saying from an old mayor named Jimmy Walker in New York, people get the government that they deserve. So that, I believe we've entered a kind of apocalyptic time. And, it really has kind of moved beyond politics for me. This has moved into a civilizational kind of thing. It's not about, I think the party system is over. I think you're going to see that. I think you'll see that in the next 4 years. You'll begin to see not only people dropping out of these parties, I think you're going to see the withering away of these parties. The Democratic and Republican parties are essentially over. They don't know that, but just that's like what we were talking about 6 years ago about the economic crisis, and I was telling you things about that then that everybody said didn't make any sense and they were crazy. I'm telling you now some other things. And I'm telling you that the Democratic Republican Party system is over as of this election.
It's a wig.
Gone.
People
get the government they deserve.
People get the government that they deserve. Couldn't get that out. So one thing we want to go into is mobilization. And, you know, being responsible for the things that we see in office or the things that we see happen and not so much letting someone else say, well, this is where we should go and this is what we should do. One interjection I want to make, you spoke about Bloomberg and his money. He actually, it's funny, when he started in office, he was worth $8 billion.
About that much, that's right.
And he
that's
took right. a dollar for his pay.
That's right.
And now he's worth $25 billion
net.
And let me just tell you, I have personal knowledge of this. When the market was crashing, he was hiring people at his company, mm-hmm. and they were doing very well.
Mm-hmm.
So, he has a whole different structure.
It's a whole different thing. This guy, well, we'll come back because you want to go to solutions. Let's say something about that. I just came from a meeting with some people who happened to usefully point out that the charter of the Federal Reserve Bank comes due on December 21st of this year. It's a 99-year charter. The mm-hmm. charter was created in 1913, and it comes up. It expires
right
on December 21st of 2012.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Now, what's important about that is people would say, wait a minute, if it's the Federal Reserve, isn't that part of the federal government? How could that expire? Well, the answer is the reason it can expire is it was never part of the federal government. In other words, the U.S. Treasury doesn't have a lease that expires,
right?
Okay,
right.
Or the U.S. Congress doesn't have a lease that expires, right?
Yeah.
So the Federal Reserve could not have a lease unless it were not part of the government,
right?
So anyway, some people were pointing out, well, wait a minute, why should this lease be renewed? Maybe we should just tell people that the Federal Reserve lease should not be renewed,
right? Right.
Kind of simple thing,
mm-hmm.
and thereby hangs the tale of political mobilization today. Because I believe that what you are alluding to actually already is people have to decide what government they wish and they have to be that government that they wish to have.
You know, when they start telling, when we start saying, or I'm saying we, but when it's said, hey, let's not renew the Federal Reserve's lease, they're going to give you all type of scary doomsday answers as to, you better not do that, because if you do that, then everything will fail. It'll be like the bailout.
Exactly.
We need to give this money to the banks because the banks need to give this money to all the home buyers. Well, we never saw any of that money.
Mm-hmm.
You can't get a loan.
Right.
I mean, maybe you can. It's a, I don't know, but.
No, you're basically right.
Basically the money never came back this way. So how did that help us? Nobody shopping.
Right, right. Because the deal was that it wasn't for you. It was for the banks. What they did was they bailed out the banking system, not the people. It's like talking about health care, where people are talking really about health insurance, not health care.
Right,
because you don't see hospitals being built.
We were just talking about health insurance and health care.
Yeah, that means that, you know, how many more doctors, how many more nurses, how many more physical hospitals have been built in the United States?
Right. See?
So that's the game. And the concept is that the people have to jump in here and decide that they are going to be the government that they want to have.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this issue of the Federal Reserve, I was talking to people about exactly the thing you just said, which is that what's going to be important to do is to get people off. See, the issue is this. Let's take the credit, the issue of loans.
Mm-hmm.
You're not seeing that money because 11, 12 years ago, the bank law that existed that would have allowed you to get that money, Glass-Steagall, was abolished.
Interjection. Yeah. Look up Glass-Steagall. Take your time and Google that. Look it up, Glass-Steagall.
Yes, in November of 1999, the law got changed. Up until then, commercial banking was separated from what's called investment banking, which just means the money that's in your bank account was separate from the money that Goldman Sachs had access to. That was for 60 years. That was the case. But then the law changed. So what really happened with the bailout was that the loans, the money that they were gambling with became your money with the bailout. You bailed those people out who were gambling with your money. But now you were responsible for their gambling debt. That's what changed. Today in this country, every single man, woman, and child has $250,000 worth of debt on their head. And that's not their personal debt. That's the now the debt that the government says it's responsible for and you and I are responsible for because we're supposed to be the government. See, the people have assumed that debt. So what we have to say is, wait a minute, no. Why don't we just put the law back that was there? Glass-Steagall goes back. If that goes back, then all that debt that you just put on our back in 2008 is declared null and void. Why? Because the people of the United States never incurred that debt. That was done by banks that you bailed out in September of 2008. We didn't agree to that debt. You simply put that debt on our back because the law had been changed so you could do that. We're saying, no, rescind that. Put Glass-Steagall back. And then take New York City. New York City right now needs an infusion of what's called credit, which just means we need to have funds to rebuild all that infrastructure that went down and maybe build properly new infrastructure in its place. All right, we should be able to do that. The Federal Reserve Bank every month right now is putting $85 billion a month into Europe to bail Europe out. This has been kept almost as a secret program, but you can look that up, too. People should just look these things up. Ben Bernanke, he made that announcement some time back. But the point I'm trying to make is $85 billion in New York City, that's 1 month worth of what these people from the Federal Reserve are giving overseas. That would take care of all of the immediate damage that we had. But they're not going to do any of this because the people of the United States have to decide. They are going to deal with the incompetence and the corruption at all levels of government, including the President of the United States, emphatically, who is an agent of that process. And that's why he's allowed to be president.
I don't have anything to say right now.
Well, you asked me to be succinct, get to the point. I mean, that's the point.
That's the point. Question, mobilization, go back to that.
Okay, well, let's look at who we are. Let's look at the country. Look at how the change happened, which is there due to the Obama campaign largely. Young people were brought in as part of the electorate, and they became decisive in various states, counties, and in the mobilization. Also, of course, the Hispanic population has been talked about, and other ethnic sections have been talked about. But really, there's another way to look at it. Most young people don't have a party affiliation. They would like to have an affiliation with principle. They would like to have an affiliation with what they think is good for the country. And they would like somebody to speak to them about that. Now, the issue to me is that what needs to be done is that the people have to decide to listen to people that have been out there. Various kinds of prophets have been out there. Lyndon LaRouche has been out there talking as an economist and has said many things about this whole issue of physical economy and what should be done. Other people like Louis Farrakhan has criticized the president on things like the Libya policy and what happened there in terms of the whole way that that thing evolved and the crime that was committed and the way in which Gaddafi was taken out of power and the United States' role in that.
Right.
So there are people who are making those points. But now the issue, how do you mobilize around that? Well, I think, you know, if a crime has been committed, it doesn't really matter how powerful the perpetrator is, ostensibly, that the idea is that nobody is above the law. Okay, so if you take the issue of Benghazi and you say that there's a crime that was committed in some fashion there, then that should be brought to trial. That should be brought to an actual evidentiary hearing, and those things are beginning to happen in the Congress of the United States. But the same thing could be said about the Federal Reserve. The same thing could be said about the credit system. These are criminal acts. Yeah, so the people have to decide. And I think you can do this through colleges. I think you can do it through various other venues that they are going to say, now let's take the Congress. The Senate changed. You got a couple of people in there like Elizabeth Warren and some of these other people who made a career of talking about Glass-Steagall. She actually collected hundreds of thousands of signatures online saying, let's put this law back.
Wow.
She got elected to the U.S. Senate. She's there for 6 years. So there are avenues by which these matters could be addressed from a political standpoint, but the more important thing is the life of the people. Right now, those people in Staten Island and other parts of the city don't have electricity and heat, don't have a place to live. They didn't do anything that caused them to lose their homes. That was a natural disaster. Their government is supposed to step in under these circumstances and say, oh, we're not simply bailing you out. We recognize that you, and many of these people are from households of veterans, for example, that served in wars. We owe you. And we're going to help you. We're going to help you not because we're giving you a handout. We're going to help you because you are a citizen of this country, and that's why your government is in existence. This is something that we can make young people, I think, particularly, a vehicle for, because I think that they will see that now that you have a re-election of Obama, there's no more excuses.
That's where I was going to go next. At the polls, there were a lot of people, and I think I shared this with you. I was like, why is this so crowded? And someone said, well, that's because there were a lot of people who didn't vote before. Mm-hmm. They're voting now. So like we were saying, this is the time to take those people who weren't, they didn't have a say, or they didn't care, or they said, you know what, I'm not really affected by this. This doesn't really have anything to do with me. Or, you know what, I don't want to be a part of it. But it's about demystifying the topics that you're talking about, because if I don't have any idea what Glass-Steagall is and how that could actually affect me in a positive direction, or, you know, I don't know really what the Federal Reserve does, then I kind of feel like, well, that's separate. I'm here and that's there. And I don't really realize this. But I think what you're saying is now is the time for all of us and the youth to mobilize ourselves and to be more aware of what's really happening in our government besides what we're hearing on the main mass media.
What you have is, you know, 50 years ago, there was a president of the United States named John Kennedy. He was assassinated on November 22nd. And next year, Friday, November 22nd, will be the exact 50th anniversary of that deed. Now, when he was president, he had this concept called the New Frontier. And despite the fact that Malcolm X and others correctly criticized him for many things in American policy that were wrong, Malcolm called him one of the best backfield runners for neocolonialism that had ever been, you know, born. But Kennedy had a vision, and the vision was that the country had a responsibility to history. And he said, the famous, ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country, was a call to service for the American people, that you were supposed to do something. You had to step up. Now that was a positive thing because it meant that people could hold their government accountable for employing them as agents of change. That has disappeared, but we can make that happen right now. Because all over this country, the needs are obvious. We could spell them out here, but everybody knows what they are. They know there's 27 million adults unemployed. We know the problems of health care all over the country. We know all the problems. Food supply is one of the major and crazy kinds of Monsanto-type food supply is not what we need. In other words, these genetically modified organisms, really, all this kind of thing. So people know what their situation is in that sense. The problem is, what's the national mission? What's the destiny of people? And when Kennedy used, of course, the moonshot, he used that as a way of saying, we're going to do something impossible, not because it's easy, but because it's hard. If you look at our country today, we need water and power. Here in this area, we need it in the West Coast. We got drought going on over massive parts of our country. You know, there's a way to reconstruct the infrastructure of our country as an Apollo-style program, where the concept is put 20 to 25 million Americans to work. Start out in tranches, 6 to 12 million first, and then take it up.
Just to interject, that was my next place I was going. All this damage that you were talking about in New York City with the trains, and you said there's a lot of work that needs to be done. Those are all jobs. All those people can be employed by doing this work. So I just wanted to interject
that. And check this out. What you can also do, though, think about it this way. In the old days, when we had the space program, people said, well, that's like out there, obviously, and it's not here. But there's another thing. Since we know that there are forms of climactic shift that's definitely going on, whether you think it's global warming, global cooling, whether you don't agree with either, it's clear that there's a climactic shift going on.
Mm-hmm.
How about this idea? We talk about the idea of outer space. We talk about the idea of Earth. But there's something called near-Earth orbit. There's all those layers of atmosphere above the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, the concept is, well, our weather patterns are clearly being affected by climactic shift.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, how about this? How about we create, together with nations that have space programs, China has a space program, Russia has a space program, some other people have elements of space programs. We have what we call a strategic defense of the Earth. In other words, we know there are asteroids out there that can hit us. We know something about the various forms of radiation that are hitting us.
Mm-hmm.
And what we need is to talk about, well, if we're going to have infrastructure, we've got to deal with the fact that, for example, we need to green parts of the West where we have all these deserts which are expanding. We have the fires that are going on out there. If we're going to bring water down from, for example, fresh water from Alaska or something like that, can we use that to green the deserts and change the climate to make it more temperate, more cool? Well, that is something that has already been designed back in the 1960s under the Kennedy administration. So like now, what that kind of a project is the most advanced kind of project you can think of. It means that you're not just bringing people in to dig ditches and to maybe do a few other semi-skilled things. You're bringing them into a platform from which they're going to be actually employed in phases till their skill levels begin to increase and improve. And you can take things like our veterans that come out of a highly disciplined military background, give them first shot at some of these jobs and their families, and then radiate out the process, like in a brigade fashion. They teach the people that come behind them, which means young people who come behind them, but they've got a certain level of discipline that they already bring to the process.
You know what? Haja has a question. Before you ask your question, Haja, Dennis, I just want to tell you, in my mind, you teeter on genius. Mm-hmm. That was a compliment. Okay. Look, he didn't even smile.
Yeah.
He's waiting for the other half of it. But, you know, if you could think about these things, you know, if you can make these things up or if you can come to this type of thing, I'm sure our government has thought about this. And to me, they don't want to do this. It's done. All of the things that we're seeing are done by design. So that's another conversation for another day. And Haja has a question. We have about 6 minutes left. Okay. So Haja, yes, I took all the time. Hold on one second.
Right.
Wait. You know, I haven't done this in a week. Let me make sure your mic is on. Go ahead.
Okay. You mentioned that we are the two-party system is finished. Okay. So my question to you is then,
what are we preparing for? Because I'm not one to just give up and throw in the hat. What do we look for? How do we prepare for the next 5 to 10 years? The next thing is that there will be more youth voting in the next election. Mm-hmm. How do we prepare them? Solutions. This is solution-driven radio. We want solutions. Mm-hmm. You know, what do we do?
Okay. Well, let's take the two-party thing, because that's the way to attack the youth problem. See, they don't have, some of us who are older may have some sort of memory, like of Kennedy, let's say, and some of the things that he got done during the period of the Civil Rights era. The fact that a Dr. King could force a Kennedy to act, which is the best part of what you can do with the presidency. You cannot expect the presidency to act on your behalf. Dr. King never thought that way, or the other people that work with him. You can expect a presidency to respond to righteous action taken by people on their own behalf. That's the best you can do. And if you begin to do that, then you can install principle in government. But here's your problem. See, if you try to put principle into the Republican Party or principle into the Democratic Party, you can't get it through that bureaucracy. That's not a principled group of people. Those people are already planning the 2016 election tonight. Mm-hmm. See, so that's how they move. And for those of us whose view is, no, government is supposed to be a tool that can be employed and deployed on behalf of the people for the general welfare of the people, as opposed to government is a meal ticket for a group of people that are going to do ads and other things like that and basically leech off the land from one election to another. So let's take it concretely. We mentioned Glass-Steagall. All that is a name for a law that got passed by Franklin Roosevelt to protect people who had lost money in the Depression. Mm-hmm. Right? We're saying we're going to do that same thing. But I just said something additional, which is you don't have the money available right now in that Federal Reserve system to rebuild New York City. Mm-hmm. To do that, you use the U.S. Treasury, which is what Kennedy did in June of 63. He wanted to fund what we later called the War on Poverty. He had an independent amount of silver bullion. It was several billions of dollars. I think it was $4 or $5 billion. Mm. And he issued U.S. Treasury notes, not that thing you got in your pocket, which says Federal Reserve note. He issued U.S. Treasury notes to fund that. Now, that caused a big controversy, because if he had issued the other notes, then there would have been a debt attached to those notes. He didn't want a debt attached. He just wanted to be able to put this currency out. It's for this program, for the urban centers. When we finish with that, you recall that currency and you burn that currency. We're just using the currency to just put people to work, circulate it. All right. Now, if young people know something like that, they then can begin to campaign, including running for political office themselves, right? And saying, well, we're going to just challenge the whole structure to say we need this done. And that's what we're running to make happen. Mm. Now, whether they get elected or they don't, sometimes they will. But the main point is they get used to the idea that the combination of mass action, like the old street actions that you used to see, and electoral activity runs independent of party structures and being advised by old-time party hacks and people who have party loyalty and affiliation and can't see voting for a Republican, a Democrat, or this. Well, solve the problem for them. Don't run that way. Mm. Run as you can call it independent, if you want to call it that. You could run a third party thing if you want to. My own view is that the best thing is to have this concept of a fluid, dynamic, principled organization. And young people and their ways of communicating become the center.
What effect does Occupy have? Occupy, the Occupy movement?
It doesn't have much effect at all right now. Mm. It had an effect by the fact that it existed. But then when they didn't have a policy, people could actually get behind. What were they really trying to do? They were putting people on the spot. But to do what? Mm-hmm. That is, you know, you're talking about the 0.1% of the 1%, right? And all that. Okay, I agree. But what are you saying? I think that what we have to do is we have to occupy the minds of the people that can see the vision, that recognize that Obama is no different than Bloomberg or these other people. You have a Nero-like mentality among these people, and we have to stop being the Christians in the arena, all right? Nice people who get slaughtered. No, we're going to get out there and actually stand for ourselves and stand for and advocate for ourselves.
Well, on that note, we're going to stop. I was going to say we're going to take a break. We're not taking a break. We're done. But when are you coming back? When will you be back?
I don't know when the train start running. Right.
Oh, man. What kind of answer is that? Yeah,
yeah. Right. I can come back. I can come back.
Tell us if anybody's interested.
Bring my car. This
please,
time.
Yeah, bring your car. It's parking outside. Oh, right.
Gotta get gas.
Well, how can anybody reach you if they want to get in touch with you?
Oh, they can reach me. DennisHSpeed@yahoo.com is good. I mean, that's the way I'd like to do it. If you want to reach the LaRouche Political Action Committee, That's a website. LaRouche Pub is good. LaRouche Publications, that's for all kinds of information and background. And what I'll say.
Dennis, okay. Two N's. And what was it at?
Dennis H. Speed, like Henry or Hannibal. Uh-huh. Speed at yahoo.com.
There you have it. Mm. Well, I want to thank you for dropping in, Haja.
No. Yeah.
Don't ask questions. No, we got 1 minute.
Still 1 minute.
No. We got 1 minute. We got to
okay,
end.
Okay, whatever.
Oh, man. All right, ask the question. We're in trouble.
Saudi Arabia is moving toward renewable energy.
Right.
And reports say, your forecast.
That's a whole other discussion. I don't think there's much to it. I think that the Saudis are your major problem. I think that you better look at them in terms of 9/11. So I'll leave it at that.
Okay. All right. There you go.
He's a troublemaker. All right. Thank you so much. And this was Harlem 411.
Yes. And we love y'all. And we're so happy to be back. This is Solution Driven Radio. So that's how we're marching.
Oh, solutions. Man. He changed it. I was just expecting him to say, stay right there. Don't go nowhere. He gave me a whole bunch. Okay. We'll see you next week.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York.
Thank you.
WHCR 90.3 FM, New York. Thank you.
Good evening, New York City and everyone around the world. It's yours truly, the voice, Maurice Watts here, getting set to take you to the love zone. We invite you to sit back and allow me to take control of your mind, your body, and your soul. Can we do that for the next 4 hours, huh? Do you mind? I'm not talking about part-time. I'm talking about completely the entire 4 hours, all right? Yours truly will be here till about 10:30, and then Howie D will be coming in to take you till midnight, all right? Meanwhile, let's kick things off with Mint Condition, 90.3 FM, New York. WHCR 90.3 Love FM, baby. WHCR New York City. To the Poconos.
I never been in love, not like this. I never had.
You heard his record played weekly right here on the Love Zone.
That lie so deep with.
It's Mr. Cedric Lamont.
So deep within.
And he will be performing this one live for you. Sit back and enjoy.
I never had someone who could love so deep and true. Feeling from her heart, only thought I could. When you came, things changed. The world around me moved. The world around me.
love shows its face. And when it does, I only but turn and walk away. What I'm trying to say is that love has never found me.
Rain comes falling down, baby. Joe. I gotta find a special friend. Someone that I'm really, really, really looking for. You're tuning to the Love Zone. This is Ollie Woodson, Eugene Glove.
If I ever leave you, baby, you can say I told you so. And if I ever hurt you, you know I hurt myself as well. Is that any way for a man to carry on? Do you think I want my loved one gone? Said I love you.
Take it easy, Wood. I want to say hello to the lovely Carol Ray, checking in on the Love Zone. Hey, baby, all the way from Pennsylvania. I want to say hello to Krista Roberts, who called to check in. Also want to say hello to Sandra Connors and to my girl Tish out in Far Rockaway. Hey, baby. Those of you trying to get in the chat room, we are working on an alternate solution. What we're going to do is post up a Facebook comment thread inside of the chat room area right there, so you can still see the show and post your comments right to Facebook. And then we're going to see how that's going to work. Just bear with me, all right? Oh, yeah.
Same. I guess it's unbelievable someone could